A very good morning to Professor Ajoy Ghatak sir and my dear India. Today we have a very renowned research persons in the field of photonics. Professor Ajoy Ghatak sir from IIT Delhi. And he is talking on the very important topic, what is light and evolution of quantum theory. I request my departmental colleague, Professor Vijay Zarke, to introduce today's resource person, Professor Ajoy Ghatak sir. Vijay, please.
Good morning, all of you, and respected Professor Dr. Ajoy Ghatak sir and all my dear participants. I am Vijay Zadke, welcomes you to the session 4th of our FDP on photonics. Our today's resource person is Professor Ajoy Ghatak sir, who is currently professor at Meghnad Jha Fellow of National Academy of Sciences, India. Our today's topic is what is light and evolution of quantum theory. Professor Ajoy Ghatak sir received a PhD from Cornell University. He joined IIT Delhi in 1966. Professor Ajoy Ghatak sir has research interests in fiber optics and quantum mechanics. Professor Ajoy Ghatak sir is a member of Optical Society India and Fellow Optical Society of America and also Institution of Electronics and Telecommunication Engineers. Once again, I welcome Dr. Professor Ajoy Ghatak sir and all my FDP participants. Thank you, sir.
Sir, please you can share your screen and continue with your.
How do I do that? There is an arrow.
Yes, yes, sir. You click on arrow.
Okay.
Then it there it is the screen.
You can click you on. This, can you see the slides?
No, sir. You click on arrow, then click on screen, and then it will start sharing.
I click on the arrow, it does not show anything. It does not show my desktop.
Okay.
It is not showing.
When you click on share content, that arrow.
Open then, share tray.
And then it will come as a screen. And when you click on the screen, it will share.
Oh my God, what happened?
No problem, sir. It will work, no problem.
Okay, screen share.
Yes.
Can you see now?
No, sir.
Just one second.
Yes, sir, no problem.
So, sab chala gaya, join now. It has again. Zoom link is the best, you know.
Yes.
Okay, this I share. Can you see now?
Yes, sir. Just a second, sir.
Can you see now?
Sir, please once again you do it. We can see you, but we are unable to see your presentation because you logged it into two times.
So let me quit and come back again. Okay?
Yes. Yes, sir, please.
8 minutes on.
Sir, now it is visible.
Now it's visible?
Sir, make it as a full screen.
Yeah, it is now on full screen.
Okay, but here we can see only half part.
Now, yes.
Now you place the slideshow, that's all.
Yeah, it is on the slideshow.
But we can't see slideshow, sir. Okay.
So, aisa karte hain, I will have a PDF made. Let me see. PDF karte hain. Let me see. PDF is often better.
Okay, sir.
Because there is a, sometimes the Zoom link is the best, you know.
But AICT has discouraged us to use Zoom link, sir.
Why?
Maybe they said some government restriction on Zoom.
Okay, now let me share again. Where is the share? Stop sharing.
Please click on stop share first, sir. Now you go on to the share again.
Okay. Can you see?
Yes, sir. Now it is coming.
Now?
Yes. Now it is coming. Good. You go to the view, sir. You go to the view and then make it as a full screen. View. Next to file edit.
View.
Ha.
Where is the view screen?
Near to file, sir. File edit. Right, left corner, next to that, view, third icon, sir, third icon.
Okay.
And then go to the full screen mode.
All right.
And now it's all right, sir, perfect, sir. Thank you.
Okay.
Yes, sir, thank you, sir.
So, I will speak, will there be a break or continuous 2 hours?
As per your convenience, sir.
Okay.
We'll take a break. At 11 for 5 minutes.
Tea around 11.
Yes, sir. Sure, sir.
Huh? I'm going to tell you today. Can you hear me clearly?
Yes, sir.
For the brief history of light and evolution of quantum theory. Whatever I will say today is given in the 7th edition of my book on optics. So everything is there. So, as you all know, Isaac Newton put forward the corpuscular model of light around 17th century. And in his book on optics, he said, are not the rays of light very small bodies emitted from shining substances? And using the particle model of light, he derived Snell's law. And people believed in the corpuscular model of light because light could propagate through vacuum and a wave requires a medium. So therefore, Newton's corpuscular theory became accepted. Then the wave theory was put forward around the same time as you all know, by Christian Huygens. And he also derived the laws of reflection and refraction. Now this is, if there is a wave, then it should demonstrate interference pattern. So here I have two point sources, two sharp needles on a calm pool of water, and each one sends out waves which interfere with each other and produce an interference pattern. So it was only in 1801 that Thomas Young carried out a very beautiful experiment. He allowed sunlight pass through a filter, and then through two holes. Young's, we say, double slit experiment, but the original experiment of Thomas Young was two holes, and it produced an interference pattern on the screen. Now, each hole, if one of the hole, as you all know, is closed, then it will produce an uniform pattern, a uniform intensity. But if both holes are open, at some points you will get a dark fringe. So if light was indeed a particle, like bullets, then if one hole is open, then it will produce an intensity pattern like this. The bullets will either go through hole number one or hole number two. And when both holes are open, you will get this photograph is from the Feynman Lectures on Physics, Volume 3. So because light plus light, when both holes are open, you get dark interference fringes. So light plus light produce darkness. And that established the wave theory of light. Thomas Young showed that the wavelength of light was equal to fringe width times the distance between the two holes, and capital D is the distance between the two planes. And he calculated the wavelength, and he found to be around half of a micron. So the wave theory was quickly established. But light was a wave. There is an animation which I am unable to show because of I am demonstrating this on a PDF. So light was a wave. So the question was, how could it then propagate through vacuum? So as you all know, the ether was developed. We now know ether does not exist. So we will not go into that. So around beginning of 19th century, laws of electricity and magnetism were developed. Faraday found that a changing magnetic field produces a changing electric field. And so Maxwell put that in the form of an equation. Curl of E is equal to minus delta B by delta T. This is the mathematical expression for Faraday's law. Then Ampere said that if you have a conductor, also you would switch off your Thank you. If all of you would mute, please. So if you have a conductor carrying current I, then it produces a magnetic field. This is known as Ampere's law. And Maxwell wrote that in the form of a vector equation, that curl of H is equal to J. But what Maxwell did was that he said that not only a current produces a magnetic field, but a changing electric field, like between the plates of a condenser, also produces a magnetic field. So he introduced the concept of displacement current, which describes the rate of change of the electric field. This was a revolutionary contribution made by Maxwell, and he put that forward in his treatise on electricity and magnetism. This is around middle or little later of 19th century. Now you have this Faraday's law. In free space, the Faraday's law is given by this. So in that equation, if you substitute a wave-like solution for the electric field, this represents an electric wave pointing in the x direction. So it is an x polarized wave. Then if you substitute this in this equation and then integrate with respect to time, that is, you calculate the curl of E and then integrate, you will get this expression for H. You can derive this equation for H, for the magnetic field. So an oscillating electric field will produce an oscillating magnetic field, and an oscillating magnetic field produces an oscillating electric field. So Maxwell showed that a wave-like solution for the electric field satisfies Faraday's law. Then substituted the expressions for the electric and magnetic field in the other equation, which describes as Ampere's law as modified by Maxwell. The previous one was, we used Faraday's law. Now we use Ampere's law as modified by Maxwell. And he substituted these two in this, and he calculated omega by k, which is the velocity of electromagnetic waves. So since these two are solutions of Maxwell's equations, so Maxwell around 1864 predicted the existence of electromagnetic waves. And he also said that the velocity of these electromagnetic waves was equal to 300 meters per second, 300 million meters per second. He substituted the values of mu zero and epsilon zero, and he got a value about 300 million meters per second. This value was close to the value of the velocity of light, and with faith in rationality of nature, he said that light must be an electromagnetic wave. And one could say that God said, let there be Maxwell's equations, and there was light. So an oscillating electric field produces an oscillating magnetic field, and an oscillating magnetic field produces an oscillating electric field. That is how the electromagnetic waves or the light wave propagate. In this left diagram, I have shown an X polarized wave in which the electric field oscillates in the X direction. I would like to mention that the concept of fields, today we take it for granted, was introduced by Michael Faraday. He said that a charge, you see, before that we had Coulomb's law. The two charges repel and attract each other. But what Faraday said, that a charge produces an electric field. And when you put another charge there, it is either attracted or repelled. So this concept of electric and magnetic fields was introduced by Michael Faraday around the middle of 19th century. So this was a great synthesis that Maxwell did. He said light was an electromagnetic wave, and whether it is gamma rays, which have a small wavelength and a very high frequency, X-rays have a wavelength of about an angstrom, 10.1 nanometer, ultraviolet rays, 10 nanometers, the visible infrared, microwave, radio waves. Please switch off your mic. So They are all electromagnetic waves. All wavelets travel in free space with an identical velocity of 299792458 meters per second. And the visible portion of the spectrum, where the wavelengths go from 400 nanometers to 700 nanometers, occupies a tiny region of the entire electromagnetic spectrum. So light was an electromagnetic wave, and using Maxwell's equations, as you all know, one can solve most problems in optics and even solid state physics, reflection, refraction, dielectric constant, dielectric permeability, magnetic materials, or everything. So Max Planck later said that Maxwell's theory remains for all time one of the greatest triumphs of human intellectual endeavor. And then in 1894, just before the end of the century, Lord Kelvin said that there is nothing new to be discovered. Once one could understand what is light, all that remains is more and more precise measurement. So people thought that they understood everything, and so therefore there is nothing new to be discovered. Then came Albert Einstein, as you all know. And in the year 1905, Einstein published 5 outstanding papers. These 5 papers are often referred to as the Annus Mirabilis papers. Annus Mirabilis are Latin words meaning miracle year, and therefore 1905 is Einstein's year of miracles. He was 26 years old, and he was in total isolation in the Swiss patent office. And there, in total isolation, not in a university, not in a big laboratory, he worked day and night to produce 5 outstanding papers. And people say each paper was worth the Nobel Prize. But he had great, as I will tell you, he had great difficulty in getting the Nobel Prize. So there is a very beautiful book, Einstein's Miraculous Year, Year of Miracles, that is 1905, 5 papers that changed the face of physics. It is edited by John Stachel. If you can get hold of that, it has been also published in India. It's a very nice book. It gives the 5 papers and gives a description of that. In the first paper of his 5 papers, Einstein described a new method for determination of molecular dimensions. How big is a water molecule? How big is that? He gave a very beautiful method for determination of molecular dimensions. In the third paper, I have a video here which I am unable to show because of bandwidth problem in the transmission. So this is he gave the theory of Brownian motion. Atoms and molecules, Brownian motion, the video shows of a big particle that collides with many smaller molecules of a gas which move with different velocities. So this yellow thing, which is a big particle, keep on moving randomly in different directions. This motion of a big particle is known as Brownian motion, and he gave a very beautiful theory of that. Then in the fourth paper, he put forward the special theory of relativity, that time is not absolute. That was also a revolutionary paper. And in the fifth paper, he put forward the famous equation E is equal to mc square. I skipped the second paper. In the second paper, in his Year of Miracles, 1905, Einstein wrote, radiation energy, light, consists of indivisible quanta of energy. The energy of the light quantum, it was known as light quantum, In 1926, this light quantum was given the name as photon, as I'm sure all of you know. And the energy of the photon is h nu, and the momentum of the photon is h nu by c, where h is the Planck's constant, and c is the velocity of light in free space. So this, it is going back to the corpuscular model of light, that so the wave particle duality was introduced by Einstein in 1905. So he introduced the light quantum, that light consists of quanta of energy equal to h nu, and this was a revolutionary concept, and which eventually led to the development of quantum theory. Using his concept of light quantum, or the concept of photon, he derived this equation. That is, the maximum kinetic energy of the electrons emitted in the photoelectric effect experiment is equal to h nu minus a constant, but the constant B dependent on the metal. This is known as the Einstein equation, and it was put forward by Einstein in 1905 and verified by Robert Millikan in a series of very beautiful experiments in 1914. So in 1905 paper, Einstein put forward the famous equation, which was verified experimentally by Robert Millikan in the United States to a tremendous degree of accuracy for sodium, potassium, cesium, and so on. Albert Einstein received the 1921 Nobel Prize in Physics for the Einstein equation, and Robert Millikan received the 1923 Nobel Prize in Physics for his work on the elementary charge of electricity and also on the photoelectric effect that I just now described. Then in 1910, William Ostwald, who won the 1909 Nobel Prize for Chemistry, nominated Einstein for the 1910 Nobel Prize in Physics for his theory of relativity. But there was so much of politics that he didn't get the Nobel Prize for 12 more years. Einstein then put forward, as you all know, general theory of relativity in 1916, which was a revolutionary contribution. And according to the general theory of relativity, the light which comes from a star, distant star, will get bent by the gravitational force of the sun. And this angular deviation was predicted by Einstein in his general theory of relativity. And during the 1919 solar eclipse, Eddington verified Einstein's result. So Einstein became world famous. So on 22nd September 1919, Lorentz came to know of Eddington's experimental confirmation of deflection of light from a star by a gravitational field as predicted by Einstein's general theory of relativity. And he sent a telegram. So I thought, sometimes students are there, students do not know what is a telegram now. And this is how the telegram looked like, which was sent by Lorentz. You can see that Lorentz written here to Einstein, confirming his experimental confirmation of his general theory of relativity. And this appeared in New York Times. And men of science, more or less agog, overexcited over results of eclipse observations. So by 1919 or 20, Einstein became very, very famous. He still had not received the Nobel Prize. That is the, I am telling you all this because we are now, this year, 2021, we are celebrating 100 years of Einstein's Nobel Prize. So I thought that I will tell you about it. By 1919, Einstein had become a celebrity. He was visiting New York and he was treated as a superstar. Isaacson writes, the world had never before seen and perhaps will never see again such a scientific celebrity superstar. But he still did not get the Nobel Prize. So there would be bitter arguments in the Nobel Prize committee meetings and Einstein would not get the Nobel Prize. And 1920, when everything was verified, Einstein had become a superstar and an international celebrity. After great arguments, people were so biased that the 1920 Nobel Prize was awarded to Charles Guillaume for his mediocre work on nickel steel alloys. It was a good piece of work, but people now say that it did not deserve the Nobel Prize. So, and in 1921, see this, 1921, there was so much, there were such bitter arguments that no Nobel Prize in physics was awarded. And the reputation of Nobel Prize was at stake. Only in 1922, Einstein received the 1921 Nobel Prize in physics for his explanation of the photoelectric effect and not for his theory of relativity. In 1922, there were two Nobel Prizes announced. As I will tell you later, Einstein received the 1921 Nobel Prize in physics and Niels Bohr also received the Nobel Prize in physics. But it was not for his theory of relativity. And he was asked that in his lecture, in his Nobel lecture, he should not speak on theory of relativity. It was not even for the concept of the photon, but only for, you see, the photon was still not established. It was for his explanation of the photoelectric effect. In 1922, Einstein was in Japan. And so therefore, he could not attend the Nobel Prize function is usually given in December. He could not attend that. This is the Einstein Nobel Medal, which he got in 1923. So as you can see here, A. Einstein is written here. And but he did not, he was he defied the Nobel advice, and on 11 July 1923, Einstein delivered the Nobel lecture on relativity at Gothenburg, not photoelectric effect. The King of Sweden is in the front row and probably sleeping because. So this year in 1921, we are celebrating, in fact, I gave a talk yesterday on the Einstein 100 years of Einstein's Nobel Prize. There is a very beautiful book, The Politics of Excellence. You think there is politics in India? There is politics everywhere. There is a politics in the award of Nobel Prize. And many good people are not given the Nobel Prize. And this book discusses the politics that goes on. Maybe Einstein was not given. In this book, it is written because he was a Jew. And so this religious tone of the award of Nobel Prize is there. I have also described in a small book on Albert Einstein, the title is The Story of a Genius. And this book has been published by Viva Books in New Delhi. But the greatest Nobel mistake, I give you 1 second to think, that which was the greatest Nobel mistake? The greatest Nobel mistake was not to award the Nobel Peace Prize to Mahatma, to our own Mahatma Gandhi. And his famous sentence was, in a gentle way, you can shake the world. On Mahatma Gandhi's 70th birthday in 1939, Einstein wrote, generations to come will scarce believe that such a person as Gandhi, ever in flesh and blood, walked upon this earth. He was nominated 4 times, but he was not given the Nobel Prize. His disciples, like Nelson Mandela, Lech Walesa, and other people, got the Nobel Prize, Nobel Peace Prize. So to quote Richard Feynman, he says, you see, many good people do not get the Nobel Prize. I myself received the Bhatnagar Award, but there are, I know, many good physicists who have not received the Bhatnagar Award. This is the highest award in India. So Feynman says, I'm sure all of you have heard about Feynman, I don't see that it makes any point that someone in the Swedish Academy decides that this prize, this work is noble enough to receive a prize. I have already got the prize. The prize is the pleasure of finding the thing out. The honors are unreal to me. And this is Feynman. Richard Feynman, as you know, gave a beautiful course of lectures on basic physics at California Institute of Technology. After Einstein received the Nobel Prize, Arthur Compton carried out very beautiful experiments on scattering of light. This is known as the Compton scattering experiment. An incident photon of energy h nu gets scattered by the electron and with a reduced frequency, and the recoil electron comes here. He measured the frequency or the wavelength and calculated by using simple kinematics, as I'm sure all of you have done, assuming that the energy of the photon is h nu and the momentum is h nu by c. You write down the laws of conservation of energy and momentum, and you can find the scattered frequency. He measured that and he verified with his theoretical calculations. It was only after the 1923 experiment of Arthur Compton that people started believing in Einstein's photon. Arthur Compton received the 1927 Nobel Prize in Physics for his discovery of Compton scattering. This is known as you all know, this is known as Compton scattering of light. This is the wave-particle duality. So, who introduced, if someone asks you, if your student asks you, who introduced wave-particle duality? And that was Albert Einstein in 1905, because the wave theory was established, Maxwell's wave theory was established, and he used the particle model of light. He introduced the concept of the light quantum, and so therefore light is a wave or a particle. And this eventually led to quantum theory. Then, as you know, the electron was discovered in 1897 in United Kingdom by J.J. Thomson. We now know the mass of the electron to 10 decimal places, to a tremendous degree of accuracy. The charge of the electron also to a tremendous degree of accuracy. And J.J. Thomson carried out experiments in which he bent the electron beam by means of electric field and magnetic fields. So in the back of your mind, you think that the electron or the proton is a tiny particle. It can be moved around. J.J. Thomson received the 1906 Nobel Prize in Physics in recognition of the great merits of his theoretical and experimental investigations on the conduction of electrons, electricity by gases, essentially for the discovery of the electron. Then in 1924, Louis de Broglie, in his doctoral thesis, said that this is the expression for the momentum of a photon, p is equal to h nu by c, is equal to h by lambda. The same expression should also be, there is no proof of this, that this expression should be valid for electrons also. The electrons were known to be particles, like tiny bullets. You have a rain of particles. But Louis de Broglie, there was no experiment suggesting the wave nature of electrons. Remember this. When 1924, when Louis de Broglie wrote that thesis, doctoral thesis, there was no experiment demonstrating the wave nature of electrons. He just predicted that electrons must also, the wave particle duality, which is valid for light, should also be valid for electrons. And he justified this because in 1913, Niels Bohr had said that the angular momentum, he gave the theory of the hydrogen atom, and he said that the angular momentum must be an integral multiple of h cross, or h by 2 pi. He just wrote that, and he derived the famous Bohr's equation. So from this equation, you can see that 2 pi r is equal to nh by mb, which is equal to nh by p. And he said that it is something like that the circumference consists of n number of wavelengths. These are the stationary states of the hydrogen atom. This is how de Broglie justified his wave nature of electrons. Niels Bohr had come to Delhi University in 1959 or 60. I was then a young student at Delhi University. I had just finished my MSc. And that's me. I was a much younger person. This is Professor R.P. Mitra. This is Niels Bohr, Professor Aulak, and other people. Professor D.S. Kothari must be here. So we heard a great lecture from Niels Bohr at Delhi University in 1959. Niels Bohr received the 1922. You see, in 1922, they announced two Nobel Prizes. The 1921 Nobel Prize to Einstein and the 1922 Nobel Prize in Physics to Niels Bohr for his Bohr model of the atom. So for his services in the investigation of the structure of atoms and of the radiation or light emanating from them. And he derived what is now known as Bohr's formula, which you these days study in your school level. And Louis de Broglie received the 1929 Nobel Prize in Physics for his discovery, for his prediction. That is the most important thing. You see, Maxwell predicted the existence of electromagnetic waves. Heinrich Hertz confirmed the existence of large wavelength electromagnetic waves in 1887. But Maxwell predicted them. That prediction is extremely important. So Louis de Broglie received the 1929 Nobel Prize in Physics for his discovery of wave nature of electrons. Now, it was only in 1926 that the wave nature of electrons was experimentally established by Davison and Germer in the United States and G.P. Thompson, who is the son of J.J. Thompson, who also demonstrated the wave nature of electrons. They carried out diffraction patterns by metal. Here, I have shown here the diffraction pattern, diffraction of X-rays by aluminum, diffraction of electrons by aluminum. And see the similarity of the two patterns. So whatever it is, if it is a wave or a particle, they are both the same. So remember that it was in 1924 that Louis de Broglie had predicted the wave nature of electron, which was verified in 1926 by Davison and Germer and G.P. Thompson. So they say that J.J. Thompson discovered the particle nature of electrons and his son G.P. Thompson discovered the wave nature of electrons. And so therefore the question arose that the electron was a wave or a particle. So Davison and Thompson shared the 1937 Nobel Prize in Physics for their experimental discovery of the diffraction of electrons by crystals. So Davison and Thompson, but Germer, who also contributed, he was left out. Why was he left out? That's a $1 million question. Why Einstein never got the, now this is a debate that goes on even now, that why Einstein was not given the Nobel Prize for his general theory of relativity, or even for the special theory of relativity, or even for his equation E is equal to mc square. There are people who have got two Nobel Prizes. So he was alive till 1955, but the question is why he never got the Nobel Prize for his theory of relativity. That's a $1 million question, and people are still looking for answers for that. Why Nobel Committee made that, decided not to give a second Nobel Prize to Einstein. There have been people who have been given more than one Nobel Prizes. The question is the electron or a proton a wave or a particle? Now that's a very important question. Some books write it is sometimes a wave, sometimes a particle. Sometimes some books write it is wave as well as a particle. They are all incorrect answers. They are all wrong answers. The correct answer is that they are neither waves nor particles. This is very important. They are described, they are neither waves nor particles. So the question is, what are those? So I've not answered the question. So what is an electron or what is a photon? So the answer is that they are neither waves nor particles. And so therefore, you will say that you have not answered the question. So what is an electron? So an electron, in quantum mechanics, it's described by the wave function psi. What is this psi? It is the solution of the Schrodinger equation. And Feynman writes in his famous book, which I'm sure all of you have seen, Where did we get that equation from? Where did we get that Schrodinger equation from? The answer is nowhere. It is not possible to derive it from anything you know. It came out of the mind of Schrodinger. So, many books give a derivation of Schrodinger equation, including my own book. But the main thing is, none of them would be a rigorous derivation. They cannot be derived. You cannot derive quantum mechanics from classical mechanics. So Schrodinger thought of this equation. So Richard Feynman writes, it came out of the mind of Schrodinger. You cannot derive that. This is very important. So I'll give you now a heuristic derivation of the Schrodinger equation. It is not rigorous. So the answer is, what is a particle? What is electron? Is it a wave or a particle? The correct answer is, it is neither a wave nor a particle. Quantum theory describes it, let us suppose, by a wave function psi. And what is this psi? It is a solution of the Schrodinger equation. And the Schrodinger equation cannot be derived. So let me give you a heuristic derivation of Schrodinger equation. So it's so famous that people have tattooed them on their back and in the front. So it's a very beautiful equation. And there have been books written, the entire non-relativistic quantum mechanics, are just solutions of the Schrodinger equation, in which you put the spin of the electron from the top. What is spin? Spin is like electron has a tiny magnetic moment. Electron behaves like a tiny magnet. And if you make a measurement of the Z component of the magnetic moment, you can get only two values, plus mu zero and minus mu zero. So other than that, the entire, whether it is this bound state solution for atoms or molecules or scattering theory, perturbation theory, they are all solutions of just this equation. It's a very profound equation. And I hope I am able to tell you the importance of that. I will describe a few solutions of this equation. Let me consider a plane wave. This is a classical plane wave where k, as you know, is 2 pi by lambda and omega is equal to 2 pi nu. Have the de Broglie relation. P is equal to h by lambda. And I write this as h by 2 pi and 2 pi by lambda. 2 pi by lambda is k, and h by 2 pi is h cross. So h cross is h by 2 pi. So this quantity k is equal to p by h cross. And e is equal to h nu. So this is h cross omega, and omega is equal to e by h cross. I substitute this here, and I get IH cross PX minus ET. And I substitute E as P square by 2M. I get the wave function for a free particle. My T has come. Can we take a break for 5 minutes?
Sure, sir.
Okay. I'll have my T and then I come. My throat becomes dry.
Dear participants, we have a break of 5 minutes. Again, we will rejoin at 11:05.
Dr. Yadav, this tea has to be provided by you.
Yes, sir.
So, Dr. Yadav, can we start?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Welcome back.
Okay. So, as I was mentioning, that if you have a plane wave, this is a classical plane wave. And I want to inject into it somehow the wave-particle duality. So, I write K is equal to P by H cross. This is the de Broglie relation. And omega is equal to E by H cross. That is the Einstein relation. There is no rigor in this. There is no rigor in this. These are just, you say, hand-waving arguments. And so you substitute this K equal to P by H cross. And omega is equal to E by H cross. And then, for a free particle, E is equal to P square by 2m. So, you write that P square by 2m here, and you get this wave function. Now you start with this wave function, differentiate the ones with respect to time, and multiply it by I h cross. I h cross times I by h cross is minus 1. Minus, minus, plus. And then if you differentiate with respect to time, you get P squared by 2m times the whole expression. That is psi. If I differentiate twice with respect to x, then I get minus by h cross square, multiply by h cross square, divide by 2m, multiplied by P square. P is a number. So P square. So the right hand sides are equal. So therefore, you put left-hand sides equal to E. So this is, we say, a heuristic derivation of the Schrodinger equation. And now, I take that as my Bible. That is, you do not ask me how I have derived this for a free particle, then this is the rigorously correct one-dimensional time-dependent Schrodinger equation for a free particle. And you use, as you must have done, the method of separation of variables, and you separate right down as a function of x times function of time, separate that out, put it equal to a constant, and that constant can be p. P can have any number from real, from plus infinity to minus infinity. So the most general solution will be a superposition of this, and that is the wave packet. That describes what is known as a wave packet. So I put a subscript x here to represent that it is a one-dimensional. You can similarly extend it to three-dimensional. It just becomes a little more cumbersome. Single integral becomes triple integral. But essentially it is this. So this is the most general solution. The top equation is the most general solution of the one-dimensional time-dependent Schrodinger equation. And Max Born gave the physical interpretation that mod psi square dx is the probability of finding the particle, electron, between x and x plus dx, and apx square dpx is the probability, which I write as ppx, the probability of finding the x component of the momentum of the electron between p and p plus dp. Now, I would like to, in order to discuss that solution, I will spend about 10-15 minutes on Dirac delta function. So forget about everything. We will come back to this equation, the top equation, later. But just now, concentrate on the Dirac delta function. So this is one of the representation of the Dirac delta function, is the rectangle function, which is equal to 1 over 2 sigma for x lying between a plus sigma to a minus sigma, and is 0 otherwise. So for sigma equal to 0.4, it is this rectangle function. But the area under the curve, the width is 2 sigma, the height is 1 over 2 sigma. So the area of the rectangle is always 1. So this is sigma equal to 0.4. So this area is equal to 1, this area is also equal to 1. This in the limit, when sigma tends to 0, so the integral from minus infinity to plus infinity, so r sigma of x is 0 everywhere. So it is 1 over 2 sigma from a minus sigma to a plus sigma. So the integral is 1 for all values of sigma. So in the limit of sigma tending to 0, it will become an extremely tall function with very small width, but the area under the curve will always remain 1. That is one of the many representations of the Dirac delta function. Okay. Now, if you have an arbitrary function, you multiply by the Dirac delta function, then Dirac delta function is limit of sigma tending to 0 of r sigma of x. So r sigma of x is 0 for x less than a minus sigma and x greater than a plus sigma. And in this tiny interval, if sigma is very small, then f of x can be assumed to be constant. And I can take that out. This is rigorously correct. F of a. So f of x is the integral of that becomes f of a. So this becomes dx integral becomes 2 sigma. Please switch off your mic. This is the usually the Dirac delta function is defined by these two equations and is represented by an arrow of unit height. So Dirac delta function is 0 for x not equal to a, and it has an infinite value at x is equal to a, such that the integral is equal to 1. And any well-behaved function multiplied by delta of x minus, these two are very important relation. You must remember, I'm sure all of you are aware of this. F of x multiplied by delta of x minus a dx is equal to f of a, where f of x is an arbitrary function of x, but a well-behaved function. Well-behaved means it does not have any infinities or something like that, singularities. I have another representation. This is the Gaussian representation. And if you integrate this function, then it will be 1 for all values of sigma. So this is known as the Gaussian function. And I plot this for different values of sigma. So you have sigma equal to 0.4, 0.2, but every time the area under the curve is 1. When sigma becomes very small, say 0.00001, it will become very tall and very sharp. In the limit of sigma tending to 0, it will be yet another representation of the Dirac delta function. So this is known as the Gaussian representation of the Dirac delta function, which is given by this equation. The area under the curve is always 1, and limit when sigma tends to 0, it becomes very sharp and very tall. Oh, this was a very beautiful animation. I wanted to show. You may go to YouTube and see this. So this, as sigma becomes smaller and smaller, the blue curve becomes, this is a very beautiful animation. I wish I could show this. Chalo. Let me consider another function. This is a very important function. Sine of gx by pi x. Let us suppose a is 0. The integral of this, I have done this in my optics book through very simple techniques. You can show that the integral is 1 for all values of g. For all values of g greater than 0, the integral is 1. I have plotted this for g equal to 5, and as g becomes large, it becomes more and more sharply valued function around x equal to 2, because I have assumed a equal to 2. These are my own calculations. And in the limit of x tending to x becoming a, so this becomes g power pi. So the value, as you increase the value of g, it becomes taller and taller, sharper and sharper. And the area under the curve is always equal to 1. So this has also the same property, all the properties of the Dirac delta function. So I have plotted here the function g, sine of g of x minus a for g equal to 200. So you see, it becomes very sharply peaked. But the area under the curve becomes equal to 1. So this is yet another representation of the Dirac delta function. I just now show the delta of x minus a is equal to limit of sine of g of x minus a divided by pi of x. I write sine of gx minus a as this integral. So if you integrate this, it becomes e to the power of ik x minus a divided by I of x minus a. and you evaluate at the lower and upper limits, you will get this. So this expression is equal to this integral. And if you make g tend to infinity, then this becomes equal to this. This is an extremely important representation of the Dirac delta function. This is known as the integral representation of the Dirac delta function. So I have integral representation of the Dirac delta function. And since, as I mentioned before, from the definition of the Dirac delta function, f of x is equal to delta of x minus x prime f of x. So I substitute delta of x minus x prime here, and I get this. It becomes a double integral. So this is now, this equation is known as the Fourier integral theorem. So I have here the Fourier integral theorem. If we define f of k as 1 over root 2 pi, f of x e to the power of minus ikx dx, that is, just take the primed quantity here and remove the prime because this is a definite integral, then f of x will be 1 over root 2 pi. So this is the Fourier transform of f of x, and this is the inverse Fourier transform. One is e to the power of minus ikx, and this is e to the power of plus ikx. If I define the Fourier transform as e to the power of plus ikx, then it will become e to the power of minus ikx. I hope this is clear. So I take any time-dependent function. So the Fourier transform of a time-dependent function f of t is equal to so much, and that's f of t is equal. So if I take f of t as a Gaussian function and I substitute it here, I can calculate its frequency spectrum. Because what it is, this is a superposition of different frequencies. It's a superposition of different frequencies. So this represents the Fourier spectrum, the frequency spectrum of this time-dependent function. So let me plot the real part. It is like this, and its Fourier transform is given by this. So the Fourier transform is a Gaussian function, and the time-dependent function is so much, so that if you plot the real part, it is given by this. So the frequency spread is inversely proportional to delta t, so that delta omega, this is an uncertainty relation, delta omega delta t, as you know, this is the coherence of the light beam. Now, I again start with the integral representation of the Dirac delta function, and I define px is equal to h cross k. So k is equal to px by h cross, and I get delta of x minus x prime equal to so much. So I obtain this from the definition of the Dirac delta function. This is all simple mathematics, and I have given this in my book if you want to know the details. Psi of x is equal to so much. So I substitute the integral representation of the Dirac delta function. And just as I did with Fourier transform, if I define a of px as psi of x prime, take the prime quantity, the psi x prime e to the power of minus I h cross px x prime. Then I've taken this term, and this term. So then psi of x becomes 1 over 2 pi h cross apx, this whole thing multiplied by. So if I substitute this here, I will get this. I hope all of you understand. Once again, from the definition of the Dirac delta function, psi of x is equal to so much, I substitute it here, then I define a of px here, and then psi of x is so much, so that if I substitute this expression for a of px here, I will get this. If I substitute this expression for a of px here, then I will get this expression. Therefore, and one can show that if psi of x is a Gaussian function whose width is delta x, then a of px will have a width of the order of h cross by delta x. This is a characteristic of the Fourier transform pair, as I showed here. So that the uncertainty principle, as I will show, is contained in the solution of the Schrödinger equation. The uncertainty principle, you don't have to put it there. It is all contained in the Schrödinger equation. And I will give you an example. So, you remember, we had written down this as the most general solution of the Schrödinger equation. One-dimensional Schrödinger equation for a free particle. I put t equal to 0. I get this. So this is psi of x0 is the Fourier transform of a of px. So a of px, as I have derived just now, is the inverse Fourier transform. If there is a plus sign here, there will be a minus sign here. Sorry. So the recipe is, please see this, if I know psi of x comma 0, I can calculate a of px by using this expression. And I substitute it here to calculate the time evolution of the pulse. So now let me go back to the single slit diffraction experiment. I have a plane wave hitting a slit of width b, and this you do in all undergraduate classes, you calculate the intensity pattern. The classical wave theory gives me this intensity distribution, where beta is equal to pi b, b is the width of the slit, sin theta is the angle of diffraction, it diffracts. And it produces this diffraction pattern. Now, I want to solve this quantum mechanic problem. So I say that the electron or the photon, electron is localized within a distance of b. So at time t equal to 0, I normalize this. So this is equal to 1 over root b, which is a constant, for x lying between minus b by 2 to plus b by 2, and 0 elsewhere. And then, using this, I calculate a of px. I leave that as an exercise. I have done this in the book. It's very simple. And then square it. Multiply by dpx, I get this probability distribution, where beta is equal to bpx by 2 h cross. H cross is h over 2 pi. Px is p sine theta. So it becomes, and h by p is lambda, is pi b sine theta by lambda. So please understand. I have electrons or photons or protons or neutrons coming into the slit. If I consider a plane wave, you will have the single slit diffraction pattern. if you solve Schrödinger equation, then you get the same probability. Now this is a probability distribution. But this probability distribution is the same as the intensity distribution. So quantum mechanics tells us that the electron passes through the slit. The slit imparts a momentum, and the probability that the momentum lies between px and px plus dpx is given by this expression, which is the same as the intensity distribution. So where will an individual electron arrive? I cannot say. Because electrons, when they are detected on the screen, they are detected in the form of one electron and never a part of the electron. So if you have individual electrons, I can tell you, give you a probability distribution. So classical mechanics and classical wave theory are deterministic theories. Quantum theory is probabilistic theory. And then you can show from this, I leave this as an exercise, that the delta px is of the order of h cross by b, and delta x, the wave function u2, that the particle is somewhere here, is of the order of b. So therefore, delta px and delta x is h cross. So that the uncertainty principle, smaller the width, greater will be the diffraction. And the uncertainty principle is contained in the solution of the Schrödinger equation. It is not coming from the top. Everything is contained in the solution, in the Schrödinger equation. Let me take a double slit experiment, the famous double slit experiment. Richard Feynman says, you must hear, there is a very beautiful video on YouTube, and you go to YouTube and you type Feynman's Messenger Lecture at Cornell. You know, I did, as was mentioned before, I did my PhD from Cornell University, and I came back to India in 1964, and Feynman gave a course of beautiful 6 lectures, Messenger Lectures at Cornell in 1964, and my greatest regret was that I never could hear Feynman. But today, with technology, all the lectures are on YouTube. You see, with technology, it is through science and technology and education, in a broader sense, only using science, technology, and education, particularly women's education, we can remove the poverty in our country. And technology is with us. It is developed somewhere else. So the emphasis on science and technology, basic science, has to be there. So you must listen to this Feynman, the 6th lecture, is on probability and uncertainty. You go to YouTube, look for Feynman's Messenger Lecture on probability and uncertainty. And I must have heard that lecture 7-8 times. It's one of the most beautiful lectures. And my own presentation is based on that. So I take the double slit experiment. Each slit is a width B, separated by a distance d, d for Delhi. So this is d. Then you do the Fraunhofer diffraction, which is given in any optics book, including my own. And you will get the single slit diffraction pattern multiplied by the 2-point interference pattern. The classical wave theory gives you this, which is done in all books on optics. Now, I want to use quantum theory. So, I want to solve the Schrodinger equation for this. So, I write down that it passes through either this slit or this slit. So, the electron is described by a wave function, which is here as well as there. And if you substitute this and calculate APX, then I obtain this. You must do this calculation. If you have difficulty, you can go through the book. But this is one of the most beautiful results, that the electron comes in, the slit imparts a momentum in the x direction. There is a probability distribution. And that probability distribution is the same as the intensity distribution given by the classical wave theory. And so therefore, I go back to the previous slide. The electron is characterized by a wave function which is present here and here. So it passes through both the slits. That is the most important thing. Now, I told you that the electron has a very accurately determined mass. So does it go half and half here? No. If you make a measurement, try to find out which hole or which slit it has passed through, you will find it either slit number one or slit number two. But if you do not make that measurement, then it passes through both the slits at once. How does the electron pass through both the slits? That no one understands. And therefore, we do not still understand basic quantum mechanics. I have a book on quantum mechanics and I still say that I do not understand how does the electron pass, Feynman very beautifully writes that all the difficult concepts of quantum mechanics is contained in the analysis of the double slit experiment. The probability distribution and the uncertainty principle is contained in the solution. So, instead of bullets, if I carry the double slit experiment or the double hole experiment, Thomas Young's double hole experiment with electrons, then you say that the electrons have a tiny mass, tiny charge. It will go through hole number one or hole number two. So you will get an intensity. If hole number one is open, you will get an intensity distribution like this. If hole number two is there, and since the electrons will go through either hole one or hole two, you should get this. But when you do the experiment, you get an intensity distribution like this, which is the interference experiment. So light plus light can produce darkness. So, how do you explain this intensity distribution? You explain that the electron passes through both the holes simultaneously. And there are several people who did this experiment, and this is supposed to be one of the most beautiful experiments in physics. Tonomura did this. Single electron interference pattern. One by one electron coming. You can take a photon experiment also. One by one. So, and you have 10 electrons, you get 10 spots. You have 100 electrons, you get 100 spots at random. Where will it land? Here is the basic crux of quantum mechanics. Where will it land? I do not know. But when it lands, when I detect it, it is either one electron or no electron. So I have an array of detectors on the screen. This is also adapted from Feynman lectures. And when I do this experiment with a large 70,000 electrons, then slowly the interference pattern will build up. The theory is so simple, but the concept is so difficult that the electron passes through both the holes simultaneously. I do a light experiment, single photon source. Now you have lasers which emit single photons, one photon, then another photon, then another photon. I use a beam splitter, 50% beam splitter. Now, you do this experiment, you say that there are 1,000 photons emitted per second, let us suppose. You will say about 500 will be reflected, 500 will be transmitted. That is a wrong answer. The correct answer is, please understand, a photon is described by a wave packet which undergoes partial transmission and partial reflection. So it splits into two packets. So the photon is here as well as here. If you put a detector here, then it is either here or there. So the photon can be in a state where it is localized here as well as there, and this may be millions of kilometers apart. But when you make a measurement, it will collapse to being either here or there. This is the same thing here. You have a probability distribution which is like this, so the electron is everywhere. If you make a measurement, it collapses to one of the detectors. Which detector it will collapse, I can't predict. So which detector will detect the photon, I can't predict. But in the absence of that, it is in both the beams. This is also very beautifully described in Dirac's book, that a photon is described by a translational state, which is the superposition of two states. This concept of superposition is embedded in quantum mechanics. You take the tunneling problem. You have an alpha particle or an electron or a proton tunneling through a barrier. Most of you have done that in your BSc or MSc. And you have a reflection coefficient and a transmission coefficient. You say that if there are 100 alpha particles, 40 of them will be reflected, 60 of them will be. No, that is not a correct answer. A single neutron or an alpha particle is described by a wave packet. And these are my own calculations. And when it meets the barrier, then the alpha particle is described by a wave packet which is localized here as well as there. So the particle, the electron is at both the places. But if you make a measurement, then suddenly it collapses to either here or there. This collapsing of the wave packet, wave function, is unique in quantum mechanics. Here is a photograph of a young lady. The quality of picture from 3,000 photons, 12,000, 3.6 million, and this is 28 million. This is 3.6 million, this is... Each dot is a photon. So when you detect, it is either the whole photon or none. Quantum theory predicts a probability distribution, and if you make a measurement, the photon collapses to that. So David Bohm, who is an authority on quantum physics, there is a very beautiful book that he has written. The most fundamental theory, which is now the quantum theory, is probabilistic in form and not deterministic. Classical mechanics is deterministic in nature. So I considered one more experiment. An unpolarized light beam is hitting a polarization beam splitter, PBS. So these are commercially available. The half the intensity is reflected as S polarized, and half the intensity is P polarized. These are now commercially available. Now, I have a sodium lamp, let us suppose. I pass through a polaroid. So if it is an ordinary sodium lamp, then 45 polarized light is incident on the polarization beam splitter. The reflected light is S polarized. I can detect it. I can measure it as S polarized with the electric vector perpendicular to the plane of the paper or plane of the screen. And the P polarized, the electric vector is parallel. Now, I then block the transmitted beam and only study the reflected beam. So this is S polarized. So the reflected beam is always S polarized. And I get it reflected by another polarization beam splitter and detect it. I stop the reflected beam, allow the transmitted beam, which is P polarized. I get it reflected and then it transmits. This detector is always P polarized. Transmission and then transmission. Now, I have both the mirrors. Now, this experiment has been done by Zeilinger. This is a very beautiful book, Dance of the Photons by A. Zeilinger. Read that book. So I have a 45. Now, these are now single photon source. These are all single photon source. Initially, we had a sodium lamp, which is very intense beam like your ordinary thing in your laboratory. So one by one photon coming in, you can think of a 45 polarized photon. I have a polaroid which I rotate, so all the photons are 45 degree polarized. Now, so one photon comes in, another photon comes in, another photon comes in. So you say half the photon is reflected, half the time it is transmitted. That is not true. It is reflected as well as transmitted. Because this experiment has been done, and a 45 degree polarized, this beam is always S polarized, this beam is always P polarized, single photon experiment. And they are made to superpose here. And it is then 45 polarized. So a single photon passes through both the paths, interferes with itself, and produces this 45 degree polarized beam. So this 45 degree polarized beam can be thought of is superposition of S polarized single photon and a P polarized photon. So this is the same thing that we had discussed, that the electron is described by a wave function which is localized here as well as here. So it's in a superposed state. It passes through both the holes simultaneously. It interferes with itself. and produces this intensity distribution. How does a single electron or a single proton or a single photon pass through both the holes? That no one understands. So Feynman, in that lecture that I referred to, you must listen to that. Electrons do not behave just like, these are his own words, do not behave like particles. They do not behave like waves. So if you say that it sometimes behaves like a particle, sometimes, that is a wrong answer. They are neither particles nor waves. Electrons in orbit, like in a hydrogen atom, are not somewhat like a cloud or fog of some sort surrounding the nucleus. It behaves like nothing that you have seen before. There is no classical description of the electron. Well, there is one simplification. Electrons behave exactly the same way as photons. And then he says, and therefore, that I think I can safely say that nobody understands quantum mechanics. It's almost 11:50. I must close. I represent a particle, three particle, by a Gaussian wave packet, and study its time evolution. So this is a Gaussian wave packet, and I have done this in the book. Delta x is, let us suppose, sigma, then delta px is h cross by sigma. So it's a superposition of different momentum components. And as it propagates, it sort of broadens because of dispersion. And this is how we. So I'll just spend 5 minutes. My time is up. This is a double refraction. I'm sure all of you have heard double refraction. There's an ordinary ray and an extraordinary ray, and both of them are polarized. Both of them are polarized. When an unpolarized light beam is incident normally on a calcite crystal, it usually splits up into two linearly polarized beams. So if you have a photon coming in here, it will also split into two parts. It will be here as well as here. It's in a superposed state. So a 45 polarized beam passing through the calcite crystal, this is an X polarized beam and this is a Y polarized beam. So let me finish here. I wanted to do a little bit of entanglement, but there's not much time. But you see, there's an atom which emits two photons. The polarization of the two photons are at right angles to each other. And they are entangled. So if this is X polarized, then this is why this becomes Y polarized. And so as if a measurement here will affect a measurement here, which may be millions of kilometers away, which will violate the special theory of relativity. This came to be known as the EPR paradox, but some other time. So my time is up. My throat is also giving problems. According to quantum theory, the polarization of the photon traveling to the left or the right is not known before one of them is measured. And if the photon going to the left is passed through an XY device like the calcite crystal, and it is found to be X polarized, then the photon going to the right collapses to a state in which it is Y polarized, and so on. So I don't have the time to do that, but Bell's inequality. I have given a very simple derivation in my optics book. So, see that. So, these are the references. These are the three most beautiful books on quantum theory. The Feynman lectures, Dirac's book, and David Bohm's book. And you will see, if you come across all the three books, each one of them has a different way of presenting quantum mechanics. Because quantum mechanics cannot be derived from classical mechanics. Schrödinger equation cannot be derived. And I, as I told you earlier, all that I have done today, including Bell's inequality, I have done this in my optics book. I requested Dr. Yadav that if the book can be made available to the participants, I don't know what he decided. So, in 1917, just after Einstein put forward the theory of stimulated emission, he said, for the rest of my life, I will reflect on what light is. And in 1951, he said, all the 50 years of conscious brooding have brought me no close to the answer to the question, what are light quanta? Of course, today, every rascal thinks he knows the answer, but he is delusional. So no one understands what is really an electron or what is really a photon. So I am an old storyteller. I do not know what the truth may be. I tell you the tale as it was said to me. Thank you. That's it. I am a little tired. Dr. Yadav, thank you very much.
Thank you very much, sir. Thank you very much for nice and informative lecture. Dear participants. 110, sir.
Very
good. Yes, and all they are starting from your lecture continuously. They are there, sir. Yes, they are patiently listening. Very good, sir. Now I request one of my colleagues, sir. We have another resource person who has joined us, so we will not take questions. I will circulate the information about the 7th edition of Optics, sir.
Yes.
Our one of the resource person
but you do not have money to buy.
We don't have funds, sir, right now, sir. But in our library, we can buy, sir. No problem. Yes.
Okay. Thank you.
I request one of my colleague, Mr. Maruti Kumbar, to propose official vote of thanks. Kumbar, sir, please.
Thank you, sir. Dr. Ajay Ghatak, sir, has given the very brief information to us as related to what is light and how actually that light is travel in the medium. Then, sir has given the very brief information related to the Maxwell's equations. Also, he has given the information related to the Einstein's life and how there that politics included in the Nobel Prizes. As for the Nobel Prize, how that Einstein has got the Nobel Prize. So, sir, you have given the very informative session. You have given the very brief session. And also, you have given that evolution of the quantum theory as the Max Planck's theory and Niels Bohr's theory. So, thank you, sir. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, sir. Thank you very much. Thank you, sir. Please.